I'm Thorsten Voller from Hamburg, Germany, and I was invited to speak about corporate that's a funny show. About corporate stuff, how to disturb people with time, because I'm doing it for a long time, for about 16, 20 years now. I'm married, I have two children, I'm 48 years old, and that's me. And I'm with a company, Steife Brise. It's a Hamburg-based German improv troupe group, and we are existing for 25 years. And we have, I just counted because I always forgot and brought it down, we are 17 people, 13 actors, two musicians, and two people working almost full-time in the office to do all the organizational stuff. And I thought it's because it's about over corporate, I looked up what our turnover is the last year, so it's about 600,000 euro in the year, so what we're getting out. And that's what we're doing with all our stuff, so because Steife Brise doing, on the one hand, we're doing public shows, is the way you say it, so the audience is coming in, mostly in Hamburg, and we're doing the corporate stuff, doing it in Europe, mostly in German, starting it to do it in English as well. So, but only for mixed groups. If they're only native speaker, we don't do it in English because we're not good enough. But for multinational conferences, it's quite cool that we speak our English because then everyone from other countries feels safe and says, oh, they speak the same level English like we speak. So that's what we're doing. And I thought this morning about it. What's perhaps special about us is that our actors are all with us for a long time now. So they are all freelancers, but I'm the general or the managing director from our company, together with a colleague, Thorsten Brandt. We consider our people like employees, so we treat them like this, and so they are very long with us, and they're just on the, how do you say, on the outskirts of our pyramids. Periphery, there are some network friends we know for a long time who we can get in for shows and trainings. So just about Steife Brise. And I thought about the products we do, and we look, when we sell products for companies, we look from the perspective of the company. So we have three parts, and so the one part is entertainment. And I think most improv groups know this. There's a corporate event, and in the evening we need something funny, perhaps a little bit theme related, but could you come over? We saw your show. That might be very funny. Can you do something? Okay, that's the one stuff, or Christmas parties or summer parties. And we call it the entertainment part, and it's about seeing and laughing. So the audience sees something and laughs. So that's what's happening mostly. And the next part we're moving to is a theme or content-based stuff. And that's why we dip in a little bit deeper. And that's like, there's a sales conference and they want to get better in sales. Or it's about corporate culture because there are people selling outside of the of the main department are not working good together with the main department. How can we change company culture? And there we say, okay, we want to disturb them, really to unfreeze their thinking, to start a change, and they should focus on themes, and yeah, that's what we're doing there. So first part is have fun. Other product is, oh, go with themes, go deeper, have some content. And the last one is the training part. We're doing trainings and workshops. So we just fiddled out ourselves. That's okay, training is more, we teach someone, probably you know, because I'm not more clever than you. I think you all have experienced. We train something to really learn how to do things. And or doing workshops, they find out themselves how to do some stuff. And the interesting part is that I think sometimes a company comes to us and says, oh, we really need this theme-based stuff. And we know they need entertainment. Or on the other sides, I say, oh, we need some entertainment in this part. So especially there's a big conference, and they ask us to come in and said, oh, could you please do short parts between the boring PowerPoint speeches? And we always say, why? Let us help to make your PowerPoint speeches more interesting and not doing the short parts between. So they want entertainment, but we are going in this theme-based stuff, working with people doing the PowerPoints, if it's possible, doing themes, complement, is it that, complement the PowerPoint stuff? So that's the thinking we have. So we are not coming with our product training, going to the company, you want to have that training, we ask them, what do you need? And then we go in this, we talked about consultant position. So just one question, who considers in the audience, who's a consultant in the audience? The consultant, who's an actor, never wants to be a consultant? Because I found out, I had a discussion with, we had it together, Nadine sitting there, with Natalie from Belgium, she's in the ITI as well, is she? I think so. I ask a lot of improv players who work with companies, say, I never want to be a consultant. They are bad, bad people. Not want to be a consultant, because it's like the big ones, like Price Waterhouse, how they're called, and they change the companies and get people fired. And I think myself, perhaps we could be a better consultant, or we can be a consultant that, that works with improv and with theater and change the companies in another way. So just change the perspective of what's our role. That's happened there. So are there questions? Something you say? I want to know that. That bothers me. Or something, because before I talk some stuff and you leave the room and say, yeah, that was perhaps interesting, but didn't address things I'm interested in. Oh, sorry, you need a microphone because we're recording it. Hi.
Hello. When you talk about, you know, changing the PowerPoint presentations and stuff, what's your process there? I'd be fascinated to know how you work with them and how you set that up and how that conversation starts.
It's not as easy to go in. It needs a time of trust. You have to work together with a company. They have to know you. So it's perhaps not the beginning that we go in and say, hello, you want a show, but we changed your PowerPoint. It's really like a consultant talk or advice talk that we first listen, or I first listen, oh, what you need, you ever considered to change a little bit, and is there perhaps some time for the guy who's talking to have a telephone call with me, and then we could change a little bit. So it's in small steps. What I told you looks like we're coming in and changing everything. It's just small steps. And so we are working for 4 years with a big German insurance company, and it started like, oh yeah, do a little bit fun stuff, and then they found out, oh, you know more than only theater, and that now after 4 years, I knew the board, the CEO, CFO, is that the board? They trust me totally. So when they have the annual conference, I have a short call with them and I ask them, is there something I'm not allowed to say on stage? And they say, oh no, you can say whatever you want. And that needs time to build up the trust. Oh, the mic.
I am a teacher in Bahrain. My director has asked about doing some form of professional development for our faculty on listening skills. Is that ever something that you do corporately? And if so, what kind of things do you do with groups of people for listening skills?
So, a faculty, what is this?
Other teachers.
Ah, okay. Well, let me answer the way around. That's a little bit of perspective. Okay, we need this, and
just I guess when you go into the corporate world for training, what are some of the things that the businesses are wanting you to develop? What kind of culture that you want? They want you to train their employees to do. Is there anything that involves listening, or other strategies that help people come together and work better?
Sure, sure. It's mostly that they have to get together. And then let me answer what we are in our company. We are all improv players. We are all actors, and we live with improv. So we teach improv or show improv and show them, oh, and when you do this, you will have listening skills. You have to have them. So, we don't have like a training, like listening skills. We have improv training, and in there might be listening skills. If you would ask us, we would say that makes us special. That's our USP. Because there are a lot of trainings out there, there's, oh yeah, you can, how to better negotiate, or how to deal with people, but we are teaching improv, and that's perhaps important for us, that we don't forget that we're coming from a theater. We discussed it very long, to go, should we move more to a training institute and see what does this need, perhaps presentation skills and this and this and this, and we said, oh, the special stuff is that we are actors. We love theater, and that's a good product, and we know improv as well. That's even a better product. So we are actors, and we are improv trainers. And yeah.
So what are some of the what are some of the things that you do within the group specifically? Do you play games with them? Do you do some of the warm up activities to get them yes anding each other?
Yeah, I think probably we do a short improv class with them, and so specific it's, I can see, when we do word at a time in the circle, telling a story, if you want to have something specific, we could do this, but then I have to point out, oh, because I see others are laughing when he's not reacting or pushing someone, they say this word. And then we can address the listening skills. And then we go on another level and talk about the team and say, oh, is it happening in your team as well? So we always connect the trainings with the things happening in the group, in the team. Does that answer your question? Because we can have a talk and I can show you a schedule of our trainings, but it's not like that we have the draw and that's it. We are listening, what do you really need? And sometimes the people are coming and say, oh, we need more listening skills. And to find out, the boss thinks they need more listening skills, but the truth is the boss is never listening. So you have to address this to change this team. And the fast solution would be to go in and say, yeah, we make the training, then we are away. Next year or next week, someone else comes, train something else. And I believe, but that's my training perspective. Most of the people know all this stuff. You don't have to teach them anymore. You know exactly how to listen. You know that, but you don't do it. I know how to eat healthy, but I don't do it. So the question is why I don't eat healthy. And yeah, June, because we record it. I hear you.
Corporate training requires the goal. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a goal oriented.
Yes.
And but it's improv training is not measurable, right? So in Japan it's so hard because mm-hmm. it doesn't see the result right away. Mm-hmm. So how the corporate training is happening in the Germany or other countries? I want to know.
I'm thinking about this a long time. If someone has a solution how to measure the change of what we're doing in improv, I'll be happy with this. And there are some stuff where you can, you're nodding, so you know it perhaps.
Trying to say it's very intangible what you're offering, in some sense. It's a huge impact, but you know, because people are listening to each other, how do you sell the value of that to a corporation? Where do you say the result of that is?
Yeah. So we try to find out a way to measure it, but we're not as far. So Of course, it's the same in Germany, that the people want to earn money. Of course, they want to. What do I have to pay? What do I get out of it? And they have to trust us. That's how do we market? We are once in a year on a HR fair, where you have a booth and sell yourself and tell, speak with people, and the most stuff is done by telling by mouth, or yeah, and giving references. And we say, okay, call them. It's a hard business, but then it splits up. That one guy is working this company, goes to this company and knows about us and takes the idea of working with us together. A lot of people are finding us in the internet. So looking for business theater or improv-based trainings and find it and like the website and call us. I was surprised about that. I couldn't imagine. Yeah.
Sorry, my question is quite related, and then I'll pass it to you. In terms of business development, do you look for a specific mix? And in other words, would you prefer to have more public or more, you know, entertainment in corporate or training? And is that based on your talent availability or your profit margin or the market?
Sorry, I didn't get it right.
Yeah,
I'm
just wondering if there's a mix to what your training is versus public versus corporate.
In our company?
In your company. And is that the mix you like, or do you prefer to have a different mix in terms of the business that you get?
We have big parts. So 60% of our income is coming from the corporate stuff. I think 18% is coming from the corporate training, and the rest is coming from the public. And that not fitting the time we are putting in. So our idea was to have the freedom to play public whatever we want by selling the other stuff. But I was in this teacher's podcast here, and there was this little bit, that feels a little bit odd, but I have to teach. I would like to play, but I have to teach to get the money to have the other stuff. So we once decided to do this corporate stuff and ask the team who wants to do it and who does not want to do it. And if you don't want to do it, it's stupid to do it. Sometimes they have to jump in to help out, and then they get attracted to this. So, and are interested in this. I like it. But it's always a struggle. So when I come back on Wednesday, we will have a big discussion about vision and mission. And I'm a little bit frightened. Oh, what's our vision? Is it the same? I think you had a question. Oh, no.
I just wanted to jump back to the marketing side of things. You said that people are searching on the internet for improv, theatre, corporate training. What makes them think, improv, corporate training, I will do a Google search? Because they have to know about the benefits, or they have to know something in order to have that desire to search.
Good question. Perhaps they heard about it, or I'm luckily enough, we are not started with the marketing. Like, let's have a very beautiful web page, have a very beautiful folder, but more getting in contact with people we know. And each of us knows people working in the corporate world and live this improv style. So I think what's so important is that you have commitment to our own work. And it's so often that when I speak with improv players or actors or even our own company, they feel a little bit low, low status with the company. That there's a company, people work in a bank, but I'm only an actor. Sometimes in the back of the head, because they're actors, they say, "Oh, poor guy, you have to work in a bank. I live my dream. I'm free. I'm an actor." But honestly, I would like. But honestly, I'd like to have some of your money. So that's. So So what I started, I made a little brainstorm. I just took the word corporate and looked what came in my mind for the letters of corporate. So when I see it C, it's a lot of commitment to your own work. That you're really committed that I'm doing improv and I bring improv in this company. And in the teachers meeting was something like, I feel ashamed by bringing improv in a company to raise the sales rate. But that's only one point. And we talked about that's not measurable. That's hard to measure. But I'm sure there are tools. There's some like this DISC culture tool, and you can measure how things change. And you can work together with universities and think, oh, let's see how is it done before, how is it done after they had improv classes. And in fact, we had some people coming in. A company called, said, oh, one of our best salesperson did an improv class. Could you teach us? Because I asked him why sales went up. But I think to accept that the companies want to sell stuff, that's okay. Yeah.
Because I'm also part of your company, and I think I can answer a little bit to this question too. In Germany, corporate improvisation is quite famous, so people know about that improv training is for companies. And I think what the Steife Prise does very well is that, like Thorsten would go into a company, and then they would be like, we need this, and sometimes you're like, well, do you trust each other? What's the real, like finding out what's the real thing? And then sometimes you would leave the meeting being like, no, you're not ready to work with us.
Yeah, right.
You know? And then they would call you back and be like, so what do we need to work with you? Which I think is really nice because you've got this reputation of people know that the Steife Prise has done this kind of work for really long and is very experienced with it. But I think, so I think there's the luxury of trust with a lot of companies, and they tell other companies, so there's a lot of recommendation already going on, and I think you're very good in keeping these relationships alive. So you would call them back and be like, what's just, sometimes I think you meet with people, just what's happening in your company right now, let's just meet for coffee without wanting to sell them something, but then in the talk something comes up where you go like, oh, that's an interesting thing. We've recently done something like this for another company, so they call you back because they are interested in that. And I think also what you said about how you started, that you went to a lot of companies just introducing the kind of work. So it's not necessarily that if they don't know about the thing that Impro does, that they will find out everything on the internet because they want. I think it's like you did in the beginning of the work, you did a lot of calling up the people, can I come by?
It's a learning conversation. It's like to ask them and really interested. So the listening skills we teach, we have to use. There's a, what do you need? Ah, that's interesting. Take it back and look what info product we have or could change and melt something new out of it. And because you just said something when we met, you was always interested, like, how could you work? Because Nadine is doing all more the festival work and I'm doing the corporate work, and we were interested in each other. So what is she doing? How can you deal with it? And for me, it's always like, I think work with corporate, it's like an improv show. So when I'm going in this meeting, that's the first part of the show. The day we are working together is not so important. It starts with this first meeting where I go in, where I play status games, not just to that they have fun. So I always just tell the story of my colleague Thorsten, who is really, he don't like corporate so much, but he's going in and coming with, and he took one of these play phones from Fisher-Price, you know Fisher-Price? It was in my car, and he was so annoyed, I want to go there, and he just took this phone within this meeting, didn't say anything, it was on the table. I couldn't do it, but it helped a lot. And then somewhere the BlackBerry vibrates, and he took this phone and said, oh, it's not me. And it was very in this real conversation about changing culture. But everyone laughed, and that changed the whole feeling. But you need time to do it and find out how far you can go. And it's, for me, it's the first act. If it has three acts, the first act of the theater play we're doing with the company is the first meeting, being there, being in contact with them, talk with them, be interested. So sometimes we have people who explain you how to do improv on stage. Yeah, you know what I think? Wouldn't it be funny if you do this on stage? And we tend to say, no, we are the experts. And I always say, oh, that's interesting, cool. That's a cool idea. May I suggest something else? That's a status game. And we know it from the stage, but we don't dare to use it in the true world. Yes, please.
I'm interested in what kind of feedback do you get from these corporations after you've worked with them? What are the things they say that worked for them, or just
what? Well, the feedback is we asked them with a Google Doc for this, and they say it changed the whole mood of the conference. That was so helpful, and people saying it's the best training they ever had, the most helpful training they ever had. What else? I'm always forgetting such stuff. Yeah, something like this. We should ask for this, but we don't do. But on the other hand, what leads me to another part, I think that's important in corporate, is to be reliable. Is that the right word? To be on time, do all the stuff, because that's another feedback. It was so easy to work with you. So they one feedback, because you have the people coming in, they get the conference, they get a training, but then the people are responsible for this, HR or the executive from one department, and he's really in stress in this situation, and to feel make him feel good, and that's improv again. How can we make him feel good? So we are really like, really relaxed. We just have become, last week we had there was a terrible conference because we made 2 or 3 months planning, and we came in there with 4 people, and everything was changed. Everything we spoke on was, no, we're not doing this room, so we built it totally different because we're not only doing the training and the show, we make a concept of how they discuss certain themes. Everything was changed, and it was so cool to have 4 improv players, and that's why I think it's so important that that they are skilled improv players and trainers as well, because everyone was relaxed and okay, listening, and I can read the minds of my colleagues. They say, shit, oh fuck, sorry. It's a German word, you know. It's a children's toy, but everyone was so relaxed because they're so in improv, and we're so, yeah, we will do it. We can deal with uncertainty, and it was a great training, and the people in there were really in a bad mood in the beginning, really like, again, something from HR. And then they found out that we are a little bit like the jesters, because we go in and train and say, we don't care if you learn anything here, but we want to have fun with you. And they say, really? Yes. And if someone's not attending, we say, oh, you can leave. I won't tell anyone. Leave. And then they want to join. So that's stuff. But very important for me is, and that what I taught all our people, you have to be reliable. If you tell them, I'm calling back in 5 minutes, call back in 5 minutes. And if you can't call back in the preparation in 5 minutes, don't tell that you call back in 5 minutes. It's totally allowed to say, I'm calling back in 1 day or in 1 week, because that's how companies work. And you have to understand this. Because we are improv, we are, oh, let's see, it's yes and go with the risk and be in the moment. It's not the moment for me to call them back. That's not working in this part. And on the other hand, it's like, use your experience, what you learned so far, because sometimes companies want something from you and you tend to say yes and. Can you do this? Yes, we can do this, and we can do this as well. Can you do this? Yes. And then we're playing a second show. Just start thinking and say, you're allowed to say no in the first act. When then there's a conference, it's okay to yes and, like last week we had to do it. But in the beginning, just say no. Yes. Oh, you need a microphone. Oh, sorry.
Okay. Just trying to add to that point as to what feedback do you get and what do clients say they got from it. Because we've done a lot of that in this very theatre. And often what people say was really different afterwards was that they'd relaxed much more. that doing these activities is not like going to a training course where you will sit around a big table. And because right from the beginning, there are activities to loosen people up and just have fun together, you'll become equal very quickly. And you laugh about it, and people often do come in with their arms crossed and say, okay, then bring it on, what are you going to do? But within a couple of minutes, when people are laughing, it breaks down the barriers. So the feedback I've had after events I've done is that for the first time, I got to see the real person. And now we have conversations rather than talking at each other.
Mm-hmm.
And back to your point about listening, yes, and we'll say, yes, we can base this on the theme of listening. But in fact, that's what improv is. However, if you don't know what improv is, you can't sell it on the basis of that. It has to be by saying, working with other organizations, this is the benefit we've seen. We can do something called team building, if that's what you want to call it. And the benefit will be that afterwards, you'll feel like you can just go and chat to somebody, whether they're two levels up from you or three levels down. It's much more relaxed than it was before. So you don't have to call it listening. Although, as Torsten says, that would be a theme you can bring into it after you've done any kind of activity. You can say, what did we gain from that? How can you apply that to real life, whatever real life is for you? So it's that kind of thing that it's about making people much more comfortable with each other and being able to trust each other more. Having done some of these exercises, which at the beginning can seem a bit, why are we doing this? Afterwards, it's very clear why you did it and what you got from it.
Let me add something. Perhaps I'm not sure if I got everything, but what's important, what came on my mind is because they want to become a better listener, or we tend sometimes to sell improv. And then we make sell an improv class. My trick I learned from someone else is sell what they want. So if they ask for listening, I say, oh, you get a training of better listening, and we use some of these exercises. I don't explain them in detail, because when I would do this, they would say, what's that? We don't do that. And it's just, what is the outcome? After the workshop, the people will be better listeners. And it's our job. I don't have to explain it. It's our job to do it. So, and sometimes people ask, can you do something to be better listeners? And you say, oh, no, we sell you an improv class because it's better. No, we sell a better listening class. Mm-hmm. And we're doing exactly the same. I feel sometimes ashamed because for different stuff, for team building, better listening, we sell exactly the same. But we have the knowledge to put the exercises in different context. And look, that's the part of better listening. That's the part of team building. In this way, better listening and team building is together. Yeah.
Hi.
Hi.
So my question is a bit specific. So I work for a sales company, and we sell safety products. Now, like right now, you know, the market's difficult, etc. So we're not. I'm not. If I went and suggested them to, let's say, come and hire somebody, like they're not they're gonna say no, but I'm sure they'd be willing to, like, how could I maybe do an exercise, right, which would achieve, or two exercises, which would achieve two goals, one that maybe could help the salespeople, like sell better, that's one, and then or more comfortable or enhance their skill, and two would be, you know. There's maybe between sales and finance, to just for them to be more comfortable, because there can be friction.
Mm-hmm.
So them to want to work together, more team building between those two departments.
So you're asking for two exercises? So look, I have the best exercise for this. No, there are no best exercises. That's like Jacob telling in his workshop, and that are the 10 rules to getting a better improv player. I would come in your company and would ask, what's the problem? Why is sales going down? I would ask, oh, you don't want to invest in workshops because sales is going down? You have to invest in workshop because you want to have sales back up again. And you know, it's a volatile world, and VUCA, I don't know if you know this VUCA, volatile, uncertain, complexity, ambiguity, yeah, this in Germany, all companies use it because the world is changing fast, and say, we're doing this. We're dealing with this for 20 years, so we are experts for this. So trust us and go in small steps. Perhaps let's make a workshop together for 2 hours, or I talk with you, and I would ask, tell me more, I would listen. I can't give you exercises or something now, like out of my pocket. There are different possibilities. I would check out, do you need work really this? And you really want to pay for this? That's another stuff. You're interested to pay for this? Or you want to have the quick solution, the quick fix, because it's not existing. You have to change the culture and go in small steps. And if you are the company who wants to the instant solution, take a high profile sales trainer and take him in, because he's better for that. We want to don't betray the improv principles. We want to go in and say, we're an improv company, and we can teach you with improv how to deal in this agile, uncertain world. But we can't give you the solution for just having sales up. And the benefit is perhaps your sales are going up, perhaps not, but the people will have fun, and that makes the sales go up if they have fun. And that will save your company because they're working good together. So it's more like this. And that brings me, I don't know how much time we have, 7 minutes left. That's so important, money. I think money. They have to pay for your work. I mean, we're traveling to all these festivals. We're learning so much. That's such a precious thing. And interesting enough, when we started, I think 16 years ago, we started to do our, I put, and there, and the first time we started to work with a company, a marketing company, to do our stuff. And there were 3 offers, is it the word? There was a low price, middle price, and a high price. And we discussed very long. And we took the highest price solution. And it felt so different. Before we had like stuff with stickers made ourselves and really homework. I remember sitting with my wife putting this on this and giving to her. I feel a little bit ashamed, like, man, please can you take it? And after that we had cool paper and great stuff. And it was so easy to say, to build a double of the price. So, and the fun thing is when I say, now our rates in euro is about, when we are trainer, it's 1,800 euro per day, minimal. And they accept you when you're expensive. So if you're taking the same, you would teach the same at a festival for much less money or no money, but going in the company, they accept you if it's expensive. So that's why I say, it's so precious, don't give it away. I have 3 minutes left. Cool. That's so important to say, build it and make it expensive. Yeah, it's a brand, and trust yourself that people have, that's another world. And sometimes, like last week, I was so angry about me because we discussed so long about the money, about the stuff, and then I came in and I saw what they built, what a big stage they built. They built 2 stages and a piano on a forklifter. I said, oh my God, that's our money. Someone else got it. Damn! So, is it allowed to say damn? Yeah, good. Good. So, are there last important quick questions? Something like...
So, for business development, do you go in with Torsten?
Together? Yes. Mostly with Torsten, but we found out it's cool to have a team to go together. Nadine and me, we're going sometimes together because... like in this panel, when I'm not know what to say, she can jump in, or the other way around, or someone can lean back. And sometimes, yeah, we had this other with this coffee company. Sometimes you meet people you really can come along with, whatever. Because I'm a man, he's a man, I don't know what was happening there. Everything I said was wrong, everything. I said something and he explained why it was wrong. I said, oh, Nadine, can you come with me? And it was very funny because I was sitting there, Nadine was sitting there, and there was this guy. And it was, I think it was quite the feeling like, I knew more about the corporate stuff, but he wanted to speak with you. And she was always talking, that's an improv game. She was talking with him, I was behind her back, and was like, Okay. Sometimes she checked in, everything okay? Like very fast because we're improv players, we can see it. Okay. And he was so happy and was so relaxed at the event afterwards. And finally he liked me a little bit. That was kind of good. So, and I just have. I have 3 minutes on my watch. 10 to 2. Oh, I have a minus 7 minutes, so it's finished. Oh, it's 2-2. Okay, I just look. What were mistakes we made? I think the most challenging thing now for us is that we started as friends, now becoming business partners, and I would. My suggestion was to fiddle that out very early. What is the role, and where are your friends, and where are your business partners in the company? And have a good financial controlling, because calculate if it's coming enough money in, then you spend. Yeah, that's all. My second assistant says I have to stop. Thank you very much for listening. There's some stuff, and I'm here. Find me on Facebook, Thorsten Voller.